Okay? طيب. What happened in this Hajj? That's the question. Do you know the details? Do you know how did he do the Hajj? If you did Hajj before or you didn't do it? Did you know how he explained? Do you know why that, how many people went to the Prophet ﷺ to Hajj? How many of the Sahaba? What happened there between the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba? All these details, stuff that we need to know. As I said today, everybody has to get himself always like ready and fill his heart with this shawq, yearning to go for Hajj. You cannot get it without knowing about it. How he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One thing that we start with, and I promise you it's going to be inshallah ta'ala, not more than half an hour every time. But then one thing when we start with, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told his sahaba that time when they went with him for Hajj, you're talking about 130,000 people. At that time, it's way more than the 6-7 million. Because comparing the population, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the sahaba that day, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take your rituals from me. Copy me. So we need to know what he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah ta'ala, when you read more, when you know more, inshallah ta'ala, you will get more motivated. And inshallah next year we are in Hajj. It came coincident, by the way, because it came in Seerah that I'm talking about Hajj al-Wada', the farewell Hajj. And we have two main topics in Seerah. Hajj, the farewell Hajj, and the second one is the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we'll be finishing the Seerah maybe in about a month or so, inshallah ta'ala. So again, half an hour, then you leave. Nobody's leaving. If you leave, you will be in trouble with me. طيب. One more time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashraf al-mursaleen. Sayyidina Muhammad, al-Nabi ummi al-Kareem, wa ala alihi wa sahabati, wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawm al-deen, thumma ba'd. The farewell Hajj or Hajjat al-Wada'. They say farewell because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this Hajj, he did it one time, but in this Hajj, he was giving to the Muslims at that time indications and signs that he's leaving soon. Because, as we will read, one of the Jewish people came to Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, and he told him, آيَةٌ فِي كِتَابِكُمْ لو نزلت علينا نحن معاشر يهود لاتخذنا ذلك اليوم عيدا. He came to Sayyidina Umar. He said, Ya Umar, there is an ayah in your book. Which book? Quran. He said to him, if this ayah came down on us, then he's lying. Because it came to him at the end of the day. If it came down on us, we'd have taken this day as a Eid. What is the ayah Sayyidina Umar is asking him? اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Today, Allah سبحانه وتعالى says, in which surah by the way? ها؟ المائدة؟ المائدة ولا التوبة؟ المائدة. So Allah سبحانه وتعالى says, today I have perfected your religion for you and completed my favor upon you. And choose Islam as your religion. Sayyidina Umar told them, and you know where and when it was exactly sent down of the Prophet ﷺ. Where and when? We will know inshallah ta'ala next Friday. Because when you talk about the day of Arafah, it has lots of, you know, it was sent down of the Prophet ﷺ in that day, in that, the farewell Hajj on the day of Arafah. So the Prophet ﷺ was given when he was, when this ayah came down, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu started shedding tears. This is an indication that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what's after completion of completing the religion? What's going to happen after? Allah, the message is came to and is perfect now, and the messenger role came to an end. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have done his job, so he's going to leave. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu got the message right away and started crying. Anyway, so in the 10th year after Hijrah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made Hajj, which is the only one Hajj and the farewell Hajj as we said. وَدَّعَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَصْحَابَهُ فَقَالَ لَهُمْ خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ فَإِنِّي لَا أَدْرِي لَعَلِّي لَا أَحُجُّ بَعْدَ حَجَّتِي هَذِهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started off saying to the Sahaba, take your rituals from me, because I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to make Hajj after this Hajj, this year or not. Khalas. He's telling them, I'm leaving. The main narrator of the hadith of Hajjat al-Wada', the farewell Hajj, and the sermon, the farewell sermon is Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu. The hadith came on the authority of Sayyidina Jabir. So you are listening to Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu while he is telling you exactly step by step what happened. And if you go now, let's say you go online, you're going for Umrah, and you go online, you're going to see what we say on As-Safa, for example, from where this dua came, what we do when we first see Al-Ka'bah, what we say, and what we do after, for example, what we do after the Tawaf and before going to Sa'i, and how we do Sa'i, and how we do after, what we do after Sa'i, and what we say in this case, in Hajj, especially in Hajj, what we do after we finish all of this and we go for example, standing or staying over Arafat. How? And why? And from where the details came is not written in a book, by the way. It came directly from the Prophet ﷺ to the Sahaba in his farewell Hajj. يقول سيدنا جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنه إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مكث في المدينة تسع سنين لم يحج. The Prophet ﷺ spent 9 years in Medina and he didn't make Hajj. So 9 years in Medina. How old was he صلى الله عليه وسلم when he made Hajj, not when he died? When he died, he was 69.
63.
59? 60. How old was he صلى الله عليه وسلم when he made Hajj?
63.
Yeah, around 61 and a half. Right? I mean, like this. 63
last
3 months.
Minus 3 months.
Yeah, that's right. You're right. So I'm very bad in math. Okay. He spent 9 years in Medina, no Hajj. The Hajj was obligated in the 6th year of Hijra. But because of, like, if you look at these 3-4 years, it was so busy. You're talking about Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. After Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, Mu'tah comes after. After Mu'tah, what else? We have Khaybar, we have Hunayn, and we have Tabuk. Very busy, 3 years for the Prophet ﷺ. So he didn't have time. He didn't get the order. Once he got the order, as Sayyidina Abdullah, Jabir ibn Abdullah said clearly, ثُمَّ أَدَّنَ مُؤَدِّنُ أَوْ أَدَّنَ فِي النَّاسِ فِي السَّنَةِ الْعَاشِرَةِ أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَاجٌ هَذَا الْعَامِ. Then he called the people on the 10th year, or in the 10th year after Hijrah, that the Prophet ﷺ is making Hajj. This year, he didn't say, come with me. Narda, today I was saying in the khutbah about this. I tried my best. I know always my khutbah is always boring, yeah. But I tried my best to split the khutbah two parts. The first one is about motivating everybody to plan for Hajj. And the second one, at the end of the day, you have to talk about obligation. Because I went home and my wife said that I heard this from you before. That this part. I told her which part? She said the second part. So I know that she heard it before because I said it before. And I admitted it at the beginning of the khutbah that it's a repetition. But the part was the shwiq, which is like getting this desire and feeling this in your heart, almost thinking about Hajj, was something that I tried to add today to the khutbah. Why I did that? Because النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعني when we talk about the obligation, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم just make the adhan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the adhan on the tongue of Sayyidina Ibrahim in the Quran. It's you have to respond because it's obligatory upon you, it's not optional. Somebody came after the salah. I believe he talked to Jamal first, then he came to me after about the shaykh. I have concentrate with me in this. This is very important. I have the ability. Today, I'm okay, healthy-wise, and I have some money. But I have other responsibilities to take care of. Did he talk to you? So what should I do? What do you guys think? When you talk about Hajj, because most of the people in this situation, you have some money. You saved up some money. But somebody is saving up to get married. No, go get married first. We don't want you to problems for us. Number two, somebody is taking care of his family. Like, he needs to, for example, let's say that he needs to buy a house, or he needs to rent a place, or he needs to buy stuff for that. This money is needed for some of the needs of the family. No, you don't have to go for Hajj this. Hajj means that you have this money extra, and then you're taking care of your main responsibility. Yeah, and somebody is saving up for education. Let's talk about education. Yani he is working and in the summer saving up some money. But alhamdulillah, I can go for Hajj with this, but I need to pay my tuition. No, pay the tuition and finish your school. And then yani when I answered it this way, he got it. Yes, I know you have the money, but you need it for something for your needs. First, put it this way. But imagine that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the call. Everybody in Medina and around Medina responded right away to the call of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَدِمَ الْمَدِينَةُ بَشَرٌ أَوْ مَدِينَةَ بَشَرٌ كَثِيرُونَ Sayyidina Jabir said that lots of people came to Medina at this moment. وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ فَلَمْ يَبْقَ أَحَدٌ يَقْدِرُ أَنْ يَأْتِي رَاكِبًا أَوْ رَاجِلًا إِلَّا قَدِمْ In a different narration, that nobody is able to make it walking or riding, and he didn't make it. Everybody could have done it, he came. Or everybody was able, he made it. They came to Medina. Why? Because of this. Because the main reason that I asked you gently and nicely to sit, because they wanted to learn from the Prophet ﷺ. It's not a matter of book. It's not a matter that you read something. You need to know what he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not a matter that you go and you copy me, مثلاً, for example, in Umrah or in Hajj, or copy your friend in Hajj or Umrah, or you go with the group. You need to know what you're doing. That's why, for example, me, personally, when I do the Umrah, I give the brothers the presentation before we go. I do the presentation to them, then I give it to them. Go and study it. Know what you're doing. You have to know what you're doing, because at the end of it, it's the dua. Saying the dua, repeating the dua behind somebody, it's totally different than saying it yourself. You're making du'as. You're saying labbaik Allahumma labbaik. What does it mean? What does labbaik mean? When you say to As-Safa and you look at al-Masjid al-Haram and you make this du'a, la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika la lahu al-mulk. Yani this du'a, what does it mean? When you say nabda'u bima bada Allahu bih, we start with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started with. Why? What does it mean? So you need to know this. So they went with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to exactly copy the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to everybody the way they did ihram from, or the spots of ihram. Can I ask you about this? What are the miqats for the people before entering al-haram? What is it, by the way? What's the miqat, the place, not the time? I'm talking about the place. What are the miqats, Yami? I'm not putting anybody under spot. If you don't want to answer, absolutely fine. But if you won't answer, it will yani add to our knowledge. Dhul Hilafah for whom?
For Mecca.
For Mecca. Ghayr Ali. Okay, so what is a miqat? Before we do the miqat, we mention the miqat. What is the miqat? What do you think the miqat word means? Exactly. Absolutely the right expression. The haram is like that. Like Ibn Bintam. The haram is not Ibn Bintam. But so the boundaries, if you draw a circle around haram, this is the miqat. You cannot enter Mecca from if you are in a plane or by land, whatever it is, without starting or getting yourself in a status of ihram, a state of ihram. Physically, you put on the ihram, and mentally by doing the requirements of ihram. So somebody coming from north, for sure he doesn't have the same miqat of the people who are coming from south. So I'm not gonna, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy. So it's not that you go, all of us will go from the same spot and we go, no. Somebody coming from east is different from somebody coming from west. So I'm trying to make it easy. Huh? Who can give me the miqat? So, as Amin said earlier, Dhul Hulayfa is the miqat of the people of Medina. That's the miqat that the Prophet ﷺ used, him and the Sahaba, when they're coming from Medina, from north down to south, to Mecca. You guys know that Medina is north, east or the northwest of Mecca.
It's northeast.
Huh?
Northeast.
No, northwest. Northwest. Medina is northwest of Mecca. So the miqat of the people of Medina is Dhul Hulayfa. طب somebody coming from Yemen. Yalamlam. Yalamlam is the spot for the people coming from Yemen. طب Yemen where exactly? South. طب somebody coming from the west. Al-Juhafa. And this is for the people of
Sudan.
Sudan? I asked. العراق قرن المنازل is Iraq. Juhafa is like you said, you're right. It's the west, you're right. Egypt and you're right. Sorry, Dr. Mustafa. So Juhafa is Rabigh there. It's called Rabigh. This is for Egyptians and for everybody coming from the west, which is Sudan and Egypt and all of this. So we have now Iraq, Yemen, and the west, and then the east. The north, which is Medina. يبقى I have Dhul Hulayfa, Al-Juhafa, that Irq, Yalamlam, وهو الحد الفاصل يعني that's it. قرن المنازل for يعني تحت شوية. That's for Pakistan and India and this east, far east areas. نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم showed the Sahaba not only that we're coming from Dhul Hulayfa, which is Abyar Ali now, no, this is all the miqats for everybody. فَخَرَجَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. I was saying today about this guy, and I meant it when I said, when you think about Hajj, يعني, wallahi, I know people personally, I know them, يعني, some of them actually my friends, and they have the ability for the last 40 years. They have the money. يعني, one of the brothers, his kids, they give him the money for Hajj like 5-6 years ago, and he didn't go yet. You know why? Sometimes that because we take it easy. Wallahi, because it's easy for some people, so they don't feel it. Other people, the guy that I said today, I gave him a story when he was talking to Sayyidina to Muhammad bin Sirin. He told him how many years he left his family? 5 years. He's been in that journey for 5 years. And if anybody يعني can remind me with the great scholar who passed away, his name because the Mauritanian, who passed away last week. Murabit with something, a great scholar. When I read his biography, this guy went for Hajj walking in 1926. Like the guy was so old, by the way, like he passed away in 1930 something or 40 something during the World War, one of the two. So maybe the second one, World War II. 1920 he went, something like that. So he went walking from Mauritania to Saudi Arabia.
It wasn't Saudi Arabia.
It wasn't Saudi Arabia, to Hijaz. So yeah, you're right, but it was not Saudi Arabia. It was something that we have to understand too. Anyway, from when you read about this, you understand it. Like lots of people, they do lots, يعني, too much work to go. Even the Prophet ﷺ, when he left Medina, guess when? يعني, today, the people who are going for Hajj this year, they stay home. يعني, one of my uncles is going tomorrow, but because he's going in the bus, he's leaving tomorrow. I said that's too early, so my mom said that he's going on bus. It's going to take him a couple of days. But nobody is flying now. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سيدنا جابر بن عبد الله سيد فخرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لخمس بقين من ذي الحجة من ذي القعدة. So 25th or 26th of ذي القعدة, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم left Medina going to Mecca. So it takes 3 days, you know, with the camel stuff. وساق هديا فخرجنا معه معنا النساء والولدان حتى أتينا ذا الحليفة فولدت أسماء بنت عميس محمد ابن أبي بكر. This guy is lucky. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took off with the Sahaba from Medina 25th of Dhulqa'dah. They reached Dhul Hulayfa to do Ihram. You know, when you go there at the Miqat, briefly, we will explain it, but briefly you have to go and start, you know, a change. If you don't, you can change before, but you can't pass with any clothes, like stitched clothes. So you have to put your Ihram on, and then you have to, you should pray two rak'at, and you start saying the niyyah loudly, whatever it is, لبيك اللهم بحج لبيك اللهم بعمرة اللهم لا حج لا رياء فيه ولا سمعة اللهم عمرة لا رياء فيها ولا سمعة. These are the things that you have to do, and you have to go that masjid at Abu Yar Ali and you do them. فيسيت سيدنا جابر عبد الله أسماء بنت عميس, she gave birth to her son محمد بن أبي بكر. فأرسلت إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, يعني these are some of the questions that we always get in عمرة, in عمرة. يعني sister has the whatever the period, so she can make the obligatory rituals and like stop the blood whatever it is, and that's what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told her. فصلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في المسجد وهو صامت, أي أنه لم يذنب, ثم ركب قصواء وهي ناقته حتى إذا استوت به ناقته على الميداء أهل بالحج, أي رفع صوته بالتلبية, وفي رواية أفرض بالحج هو وأصحابه. So سيدنا جابر said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم went first, prayed two rak'at, quiet. Then he left the masjid, he ride his camel, she camel القصواء. Then once she start moving, he started صلى الله عليه وسلم التلبية. Okay, and now you are in a state of ihram. Now there are lots of restrictions that you cannot do, including but not limited to cutting hair or nails, you cannot. Putting perfume, you cannot. Eating or drinking, you cannot. So having a relationship with the wife, you cannot. Doing a marriage contract, you cannot. Hunting the land or the wild one, you cannot. Okay. Many things like that you cannot do while you're going from Mecca. خلاص, you did your ihram, you are in the state of ihram. Yeah, but this is a recommendation, but this is not one of the things that nullifies your ihram. Like Zaman said, the ayah in Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Al-Hajj ashhurun ma'lumat. Hajj is in certain months. What are the months of Hajj, by the way? Yeah, start with me. Ramadan, Shawwal. So Ramadan is not with them. Okay, JazakAllah khair Hanif. Okay, so the months of Hajj. Why? Because people used to go out for Hajj in Shawwal. Allah, Ramadan is over. The months of Hajj are Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, and Dhul Hijjah. But what are the sacred months? And how many are they? We have four sacred months. What are they? نعم محرم رجب. So always think about, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, there are four sacred months. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that in Surah Tawbah, إن عدة الشهور عند الله تعالى منها أربعة حرم. Four sacred months. Three of them consecutive comes right after one another: ذو القعدة, ذو الحجة, and محرم. ورجب مضر. The only month by itself is the month of Rajab, Mudar. I explained it before. Who can yani, remind me? Why Mudar? What does it mean, Mudar?
The tribe called Mudar that used to keep the accurate times of the...
Exactly. Oh, one of the things that we will tackle actually in the verbal Hajj, subhanAllah. You guys have to wait with me until we finish this. Not today, but every week we sit together to finish this. Hajj, the farewell Hajj has lots of things. And today I was doing marriage contract. One of the main advice that the Prophet ﷺ gave to us in his farewell Hajj, to take care of the women. Take care of your women. استوصوا بالنساء خير. As well as he gave an advice about the salah, take care of your salah, establish your salah. But one of the main things, amazing things that happened actually in that Firmul Hajj, which is yani get along, I'll come in coincident with the hadith that we said earlier, of the ayah that we said earlier, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has perfected your religion for you. Part of the perfection is that the time comes back to normal. The four sacred month was something that the Arab used to respect. So they didn't used to fight in it. However, to be able to fight, they used to push this month a little bit in order for them to be able to fight. Actually, they did that. So they mixed the whole year. So nobody knows which month is which. So this tribe has Muharram this month. It's the other tribe has it as Safar, for example, because they played with the month. One of the amazing ahadith that came in that time, that today at the Firmul Hajj, إن الزمان قد استدار كهيئته يوم خلق الله السماء. Now time come back to normal. The year has 12 months. Four of them are sacred months. Then the Prophet ﷺ counted them: ذو القعدة, ذو الحجة, right? Muharram, and then ورجب مضر. ورجب is the right calculation of the tribe Mudr. They were the only one who keep track of the right order of the month of Rajab. Subhanallah, one of the amazing things that happened is that the time clock took the Prophet ﷺ 23 years to fix what the Arab the spoiled for years and years. Anyway, فنظرت إلى مد بصري. سيدنا جابر بن عبد الله said that I looked around and as far as I can see, there is people. On the right hand side of the Prophet ﷺ, on the left hand side of the Prophet ﷺ, in front of the Prophet ﷺ, the back of the Prophet ﷺ, عن يمينه يعني من بين يديه صلى الله عليه وسلم, من بين يديه, in front of him, right ابن وماش, وعن يمينه, right hand side, وعن يساره مثل ذلك, ومن خلفه مثل ذلك, ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بين أظهرنا وعليه ينزل القرآن. And the Prophet ﷺ is amongst us, is in the middle, and the Quran is revealed, is being revealed on the Prophet ﷺ. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. وعليه ينزل القرآن وهو يعرف تأويله. And he knows the interpretation of what he is getting صلى الله عليه وسلم. فأهل بالتوحيد. The first thing that he said صلى الله عليه وسلم after putting on his إحرام 12, لبيك اللهم لبيك. لبيك. Today I was reading in the process of, by the way, I'll give you some secrets about me, those who attend the khutbah. I can prepare the khutbah بفضل الله. This is the favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in 10 minutes. But I might take 5 days choosing the topic. That's my, يعني, it's bad thing in me, يعني, but alhamdulillah. So I was like trying to, should I talk about the wisdom behind Hajj? Should I talk about this? So I read a little bit here and there and here and there. So one of the things that when you look for the wisdom, يعني ما هي الحكم? And some people, by the way, when they try to raise doubts, they will tell you on the black stone, along with يعني الكعبة around it, is something from the remains of Jahiliyyah, right? Then the Arab used to go around it and kiss the black stone. They used to do all this, okay? Yahi, it's not this. Yahi, it's part of taslim, submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The main wisdom behind Hajj, as I said in the khutbah, just taslim, submission. He said to you, come, you go. By the way, I believe in it. Wallahi al-Azim, I believe it 100%. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you, come, you will go. I'm following some news in Egypt today, somebody started a new team and a new channel, and he's calling all the people of the soccer who has experience in soccer, because he's providing them with money. And the money is like for little thing, like he's some money. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you everything and he's saying you come, you go. That's it. That's the wisdom, by the way. Yani out of many things that you can get behind the head, but the main thing, لبيك اللهم لبيك. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, labbaika means, here I am. I heard the call, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, and I respond. That's it. That's why you started your Hajj with labbaika Allahumma labbaik, labbaika la sharika laka labbaik, إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ وَالنِّعْمَةَ لَكَ وَالْمُلْكِ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ. And then everybody did the same like the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. I'm still within the half hour, right? No, I'm serious. Did I take more than 30 minutes?
Yes, sure.
No, no, 30 minutes? Yes. Okay, sorry, this is the Canadian time. I told you guys Egyptian time, so. Masri time. No, we'll finish soon, inshallah. I promised you, because I don't want to lose you next week. And tomorrow too. وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ وَلِيَ النَّاسُ وَالنَّاسُ يَزِيدُونَ لَبَّيْكَ ذَا الْمَعَارِجِ لَبَّيْكَ ذَا الْفَوَاضِلِ فَلَمْ يَرُدْ رَسُولَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَيْهِ شَيْئًا مِنْهُ. By the way, the Sahaba, they added lots of madh, praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم accepted all. He never rejected any of that. وَلَزِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. But the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم never added more than لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ لَبَّيْكَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ لَبَّيْكَ إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ وَالنِّعْمَةَ لَكَ وَالْمُلْكُ. وَالنَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم said clearly, اللهم حج لا رياء فيه ولا سمعة لبيك بحج. You have to say it if you're going for Umrah or going for Hajj. You have to say it clearly. This is the talbiyah for Hajj. This is the talbiyah for Umrah. For both, if you're taking Hajj with you. What happened after when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم passed? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم left Medina. When you leave Medina for Hajj or for Umrah, you leave your place for Hajj or for Umrah, you go to the Miqat, you start your Ihram, and then you move to Mecca. Entering Mecca has lots to know about it. Once you enter Mecca by itself, once you enter the Masjid al-Haram, what you do, the first thing, again, the tawaf, the sa'i, the staying at Maqam Ibrahim. After that, there are the details. I don't think that we'll be able to cover this all, inshallah ta'ala. So we'll start next time from after leaving, getting in the state of Ihram and going towards Mecca. What did he do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Sahaba? That will be the start of the discussion next week, inshallah ta'ala. Tomorrow, again, as I said, sitting, it gives me a chance to discuss things with you. So I kept the Hellfire agenda also, like I kept these two topics. The Hajj al-Wada' and the farewell and the death of the Prophet until after we finish the combining. So inshallah ta'ala, tomorrow in the journey to the hereafter, we'll be talking more and more about something that we have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every single moment to save us from, which is the hellfire. Before we talk inshallah ta'ala about something that we know, we have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us it all the time, which is Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all Jannah and make us from the people of Jannah. I'll see you tomorrow inshallah ta'ala right after Salat al-Maghrib for half an hour with the journey to the hereafter. Then but I'll see you for sure Friday and Saturday with this until we finish the seerah together. Tafaddal
Dr. Mustafa. Sheikh, how many people used to make Hajj before the Dead Sea?
I don't think that anybody went for Hajj. So, waiting, it was the Prophet ﷺ was waiting to give them the details of Hajj until then. But I need to double check it. That's a good question.
What was it?
Oh, what is it? That's one of the questions, man.
No, I said
the same mentality. Yani if Hajj was obligated the 6th year after Hijrah, and the Prophet ﷺ went for the first time in the 10th year after Hijrah, so in these 3 years, so how the people used to make Hajj, or did they do Hajj, or they were waiting for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? We need to...
Well, there was a Hajj of Abu Bakr on the 19th.
Exactly, so that's but how, based on what? The details of the Hajj. I think that Mustafa is asking this, like there was any structure for Hajj before that, or just like the main thing? I really don't know, I need to double check. But remind me, Lord Chief. Any other questions? Okay. So I'll see you tomorrow, inshallah. JazakAllah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.